we're going to look at large-scale entanglement and how we create it using the GHZ circuit. So what is GHZ? GHZ is a special circuit that defines how to entangle n qubits, so more than two. Why do we need to learn about it? Entangled states that contain a large number of qubits are required for representing multiple integers in superposition, communication protocols, such as those used for distributed quantum computing, and cryptography applications. Let's review two-qubit entanglement. We know that if we take two qubits in state ket zero and pass one of them through an H gate and then both of them through the C naught gate, we get a same entangle state without phase. So same entangle, meaning that we have a ket zero zero and a ket one one. So here we have the Brockett notation and the vector notation. Entangled states cannot be separated and must be treated as one unified system, even if they're a large distance away. Action on one part of the system will directly impact the others. Mathematically, an entangled state cannot be factored. Here we have a non-entangled state, so 1 over square root of 2 times ket 0, 0 plus ket 0, 1. We can see that both of these basis values within the quantum state have a zero as the first qubit value. Because of that, we can factor it out. An entangled state, however, you cannot factor out any components of the state. You have to treat it as one uniform system. We call systems maximally entangled when the kets have equal and maximized probabilities. So in this case, when we have two basis values within the state, that will be 1 over square root of 2, giving us a 50% chance that we're in one state or another. So how can we tell if qubits are maximally entangled? If we look over here to the left in the blue box, we see that all of these states are entangled. We cannot factor any component out. We can also see that each of the basis states has the same probability and it's the maximum possible, so 1 over square root of 2. We can see the visual representation showing that all kets have a 50% probability. If we look to the right, we see some examples of states that are not entangled or not maximally entangled. Here, we have an entangled state, but it has an imbalance in probabilities. We can see that with our visual representation. Below, we see that we have equal probabilities, but the three-qubit state can be separated. So these three qubits aren't actually entangled. We can check that out with the visual representation here. Here we have our circuit that generates same entangle without phase. And we use a C naught gate to extend this, our state after H. So we have our first qubit in superposition and then ket 0, 0 to make the following state. This is not an entangled state. Then after the first C naught, we have our entangled state appear between these first two qubits. But this last qubit is not entangled with the other two. We can see that here. If we add a second C naught gate, we can see that we are able to create a fully entangled three qubit state. This is an example of multipartite entanglement. So to summarize, we can use additional C naughts to entangle more qubits. Let's define the GHZ state. So that stands for Greenberger, Horn, Zellinger. GHZ states are entangled states that have at least three qubits. So if you want to entangle an n qubit entangled state, it's possible to do so with one H gate and n minus one C naught gates. So in this case of three qubits, we have one H gate to create superposition, and then we have two C naught gates applied. Are there other ways to implement the GHZ circuit? Let's check it out. Let's see if four qubits can become entangled using these two different circuits. So here we have an initial state of ket 0, 0, 0, 0. And after the Hadamard gate, our state is transformed so that our first qubit is now in superposition. We have the following state. So far, the circuits are the same. So we have our first state that we just calculated. And now we're going to pass that state through our first CNOT operation. After the first CNOT operation, these circuits are the same. We look at the visual representation. Now our top portion of the state has a second black ball. Let's see what happens when we pass through that third CNOT gate. This is where circuits appear to be a little different, because here the top qubit is acting as control, and here the second qubit is acting as control. So we can see the control qubits highlighted in that second basis state. So after the second CNOT, we have the following state. So all zeros in the first basis state, three ones and a zero in the second basis, and we get the same over here. If we were looking at the visual representation, we see that now we have one additional black ball in the top portion that represents the total state of the system. Even though the CNOT control placement differs in these two circuits, the output is the same after the second CNOT. Finally, we will pass through that last CNOT operation. So we both start with the same state, where we have 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0 for both circuits. And once again, we have different qubits acting as controls. So after the third CNOT, we get a maximally entangled state for those four qubits. And same over here. Both of these circuits are identical, and they created four qubit entanglement. Even though they use different controls, they accomplish the same thing. You can create the GHZ circuit with having the top qubit acting as the control, or you can have it in this more laddered structure where the previous target can become the control. These will both accomplish the same thing for an end qubit state. Why use a different structure? Both of these circuits might result in the same output state, but the right circuit might be easier to actually construct on a physical device, especially if your qubit-qubit connections are limited. Here we have the IBM Toronto device, and we can only communicate with those qubits that are immediately adjacent to us. So because of that, it will be easier to implement this right version of the GHZ circuit as opposed to this one to the left. Let's do an example. We're going to apply a NOT gate after the generation of a three qubit GHZ state. So here we get our state, and then we apply a NOT gate. What happens to the entangled state? It's going to cause this first qubit to flip its value. So now we have ket 100 and ket 011, and both of those multiplied by 1/√2 for our quantum state. This resulting state is still maximally entangled. And why? It's because we cannot factor it, and we have 1/√2 multiplying both of the basis values in this state. This state is an extension of the opposite entangled state that we learned about earlier. All three qubits have to be treated as a combined system. What is the output state for the following circuit? When we look at the circuit, we see that we have a five qubit GHZ circuit. So that's going to give us a maximally entangled five qubit state. That's an extension of the same entangled state. After we add some NOT gates, we are going to see that the second and the fourth qubit are going to flip their values. With that in mind, we know that we're going to see state D output from the circuit. GHZ states have a lot of use cases as examples of multipartite entanglement. So for example, if we look at a lot of communication protocols, they use entanglement that is shared among several parties. It's also used in a lot of quantum cryptography applications.